That's live now. Thank you. There's still a few people joining, so you better manage it.
Okay, so we're live now. There are some people already online, are there, Paul?
Yeah.
Okay. Paul, perhaps you could just let us know if in a couple of minutes' time, if there's no further people joining, then we'll actually commence the presentation.
Seems to be no thank you, right? Go ahead.
Okay. Unfortunately we can't see who we're addressing here, but I'm assured that there are people on the other side of the internet here. So look, thank you for taking the time out of your day just to see this presentation. You know, we do think it's important that we do explain what it is we're proposing to do and give you the reasons why. As I say, this will be available on the internet afterwards, this presentation, and there will be contact details at the end if people have queries they wish to raise. So look, I'll start with our first slide and really just explaining who this presentation is for. It's primarily aimed at agents who are responsible for compiling application information, and it relates to full plan applications only. So to set the scene, you know, why are we doing this? We had planned to do this actually now nearly 2 years ago, and we had sought the approval of members to start this process. But unfortunately, COVID came upon us, and really we thought with everything else the construction industry had to deal with during the real impactful time of COVID, we didn't think it was appropriate to launch this initiative at that stage. I think at this stage now, we're all fairly used to the new ways of working. So we think this is now an appropriate time to do this, given the importance of it. So to set the scene, you know, why are we looking to review how we validate and approve applications? There are a number of reasons for that. It's certainly our opinion that too many of the applications that we receive are of insufficient quality. You know, that is, you know, really evidenced by the fact that we have a fairly low percentage of applications that are approved first time. Unfortunately, too many applications require multiple assessments, with subsequent submissions being inadequate. So, you know, in terms of our own operations, that slows down the whole building control operation, which adversely impacts on both those who do send low quality submissions, but unfortunately it also impacts on those who do submit, you know, adequate applications. There's also a financial reason in that the department's fees, standard fees, are based on the assumption that we are receiving adequate quality submissions, and certainly aren't sufficient to cover multiple reassessments of the same application due to its low quality. Okay, in terms of demonstrating compliance, it's a two-stage process. There's obviously a valid application, and then there has to be sufficiently detailed, clear, comprehensive submission. So looking at that stage one, validation. So what constitutes a valid application? A valid application comprises three things: a completed application form with all the necessary information on it, the correct fee, and then drawings and supporting technical information with sufficient level of detail to enable a proper assessment of the proposed works. So looking in a little bit more detail in the application, you'll all be familiar with our standard application. It is important that all sections are completed, and agents do take the time to do that. Literally, they're only slowing down the process if we have to go back and key windows haven't been filled out there. We'd ask you to pay particular notice of the note in terms of the privacy statement. as I say, the documents are available online. In terms of the application fee, in terms of items 1 to 12, it's standard fees. And then for items 13 and 14, it's based on the estimated cost of the works. So it's important to reiterate what that definition is of estimated cost. And from the regulations, it is, from the legislation, is estimate in relation to the cost of carrying out building work means a written estimate accepted by a district council of such reasonable amounts as would be charged for the carrying out of that work by a person in business to carry out such work, and references to estimated costs shall be construed accordingly. So, in summary, your estimated costs do have to be realistic and in line with what might be called industry norms here in the Northwest. Obviously, there are exemptions to this, and primarily around disabled exemptions. And where these apply, then we require an occupational therapist report, which has to clearly state the person has a physical impairment, that the existing facilities in the dwelling aren't suitable, and sets out clearly the scope of works required under the exemption. You know, there may be the case that contained within application there's works that are both exempt and works that are not exempt. That has to be clearly identified. Drawings and technical information. It's specified in Schedule 3 of the regulations that we require two copies of the information, with an additional two copies for the Northern Ireland Fire Rescue Service for non-domestic applications. Drawings should include floor plans, sections, etc., existing and proposed. A block plan showing adjoining buildings and boundaries, drainage proposals, and sufficient site levels for identifying and checking the means of access. Schedule 3 states that drawings shall be executed or reproduced in a clear and intelligible manner and to an appropriate scale. You know, we really can't emphasize enough that drawings, you know, are of a standard that should be reasonably expected from a qualified design consultant. Other relevant technical information may include soil or ground investigation reports, structural engineers information, fire safety information, mechanical engineers information, energy assessments, and issues like UV, SAP calcs, etc. You know, any experienced agent should know what additional technical information they need to supplement their application. It shouldn't be building controls officers' jobs to go chasing what is obvious information or any shortcomings in the information supplied to us. A valid application, then, in summary, contains a fully completed application form. Details required for the application fee to be determined and the plan fee in full. All technical information to demonstrate compliance with the relevant regulations. We then come to the second stage, and that's the assessment of the application. And I've sort of got a bit behind here with the slides, sorry folks. An approvable application is achieved when once it's valid, and council will assess and make a determination. In line with Building Control Order 1979, Article 13, plans deposited of, with the council 13.1, where plans of any proposed works are deposited with a district council in accordance with the building regulations, the district council shall, subject to paragraph 3A, if the plans are neither defective nor show that the proposed works would contravene any building regulation, pass the plans, or if the plans are defective or show that the proposed works would contravene any building regulation, reject the plans. So if the plans are rejected, a rejection notice will be issued. It'll detail issues to be addressed. Council will await a response from the agent. It'll then reassess the information. Upon further rejection, the applicant stroke agent feel aggrieved on possibly council's interpretation of the regulations or technical booklet, etc., there is a right of appeal there. It should also be noted that there's an expiry limit of 56 days from when the notice is issued. If all the issues are addressed fully, then approval will be granted. So it's probably worth considering what are the most common reasons for council rejecting applications. And the first of these are poorly structured drawing notes. These are notes that are inaccurate, i.e. showing out of date standards, are unintelligible or not related to the works. And I suppose you can guess this is where people are cut and pasting in notes from one application to the next without really taking the time to see, are they still all current and are they relevant to the application? I suppose inconsistencies there's the knock-on effect that poorly structured drawings also provide no assistance to the builder. It's nobody's interest to have drawings, poorly detailed drawings in the wider process of the construction of buildings. Inconsistent drawings where we have conflicting information across either drawings or even within the one drawing. Another problem is drawings across the discipline should be coordinated and consistent. Obviously, if there's obvious discrepancies between the various different disciplines in their design information, then it's not for building control to try to guess, nor a builder guess, you know, which way to interpret things. The drawing should be where your multiple disciplines of consultants on board, then you know the responsibility sits with the lead consultant there to make sure the end package is fully coordinated. So in summary, we are endeavouring to streamline the process, and that's for the benefit not just of council, but for applicants who use agents as their expert advice. So it's important equally to the applicant out there that the process moves as quickly and efficiently as possible and doesn't get bogged down in multiple resubmissions. We certainly, in terms of our own KPIs, want to see a much higher percentage of first-time approvals. And then agents who invest the time compiling complete applications will benefit from faster responses and earlier approvals. And, you know, from the point of view, agents who have to manage their own fees on projects, it can't be efficient for agents if they get caught up in a process of multiple submissions and reassessments. So, as I say, it's a short and sweet presentation. This hopefully sufficiently clear to you the direction of travel we're going within this. I'm sure it will throw up some questions and queries, and we're content to take those through the email address shown there, which is our building.control@derrystrabane.com. As we compile a list of the questions that come in, we will also then develop a frequently asked questions and answers document for the benefit of agents so that you all see the sort of types of questions that were being asked. So that concludes our presentation. Guys, I'm not sure, do we have the ability to take questions here and now?
Yeah, Frank, there's two questions in that. I'm going to give it to you.
Yeah.
Okay, the first question is, can full applications be submitted online?
Not yet. It's a position we'd like to get to, but such are things that at the moment we just do not have the IT facilities to do that, but it's certainly a goal that we want to get to.
Second question is from Derek. He says, when calculating the fee for a house in excess of 250 meters squared, would a base of storage within the main dwelling or ground and first floor garage storage be included in the floor area calculation?
I'm going to throw that over to one of my colleagues to answer here. David, would you fancy hazarding a guess at that one, or an answer, I should say?
Yeah, Derek, could I ask you maybe just to send that in through the building.control email address? And that's a really a wee bit outside the scope of this presentation. So we can come back to you that separately on an email.
Okay.
There's another one just came in there. Are there additional fees to be paid with the rejection notice?
No.
No.
If the work is substantially the same, then there would be no additional fee following a resubmission. But if the work changes significantly, then there would be the potential to charge another plan fee in that particular case.
Got another question now, please. Will a rejection notice be issued to the applicant at the same time as agent? Is this going to cause unnecessary concerns for the applicant?
Yes, it is. It is the intention that the applicant will be informed. That is correct, David, isn't it?
Yes, that's right.
Yep. You know, obviously, you know, we owe a duty to keep everybody in the process informed, and we think it's important that the applicant does know, that their application hasn't passed first time, so that if they are concerned about reasons for delay and whatever, they certainly understand possibly one of them.
Another question, this is the final one. Are you happy to receive clarification questions prior to submission?
Well, I'll take that, David. Yes, you know, provided it's relatively straightforward, we welcome questions before an application comes in.
Obviously, we have a process, you know, if there's a substantial application, we can have a pre-application discussion or meeting with, but that would tend to be on, you know, significant projects.
Okay, next question. If the previous advisory notice now becomes a rejection notice, does the whole package of drawings, et cetera, get returned to be resubmitted?
No, we would be sending out the rejection notice identifying the reasons for rejection, which would previously have been the advisory note. And then we would then welcome a resubmission with the amended drawings, which we will then reassess. But no, the drawings will not be sent back to you along with a rejection notice.
I think that's every question, unless anybody else wants to put one in there before we finish off.
Well, look, I would just reiterate, obviously, maybe something will come to mind when you think a wee bit more about this, the practicalities, and certainly we would welcome any questions at the email address below there. And as I say, if we do get, you know, a reasonable number of additional questions that we haven't covered here already, then we would certainly be happy to produce a set of questions, frequently asked questions and answers. Nothing else has come through, Paul, has it?
No, that's everything, I think, Frank.
Okay, look, for those of you that have logged on to this, look, appreciate, as I say, taking the time out of your day to do so. And if you want to look at the presentation again there, it'll be available. Guys, it's. I thought it was going to be on YouTube, but it's not, Paul. Where is it available to see again?
It will be a YouTube channel, yeah.
Oh, sorry, so it's Council's YouTube channel. So if you want to run through that application, if you've missed anything, please do visit that again, and it'll be there for some time. And as I say, look, we can take questions as well. So okay, look, thank you for attending, and hopefully this change doesn't present any problem to those of you who as a rule send in adequate applications. Okay, thank you. Thank you.